Hello and welcome. You're watching Science Monitor, where you get to know the most significant news from the world of science, technology, innovation, research, discoveries, and much more. I'm Aishwarya Kapoor with you. Let us get started with this week's headlines. ISRO and CSIR sign an MOU to increase accuracy in satellite navigation and reduce India's dependency on US-based GPS for accuracy in time. Scientists at the IISER Kolkata find a new substance that can protect wood, paper and metals from fire, water and corrosion. Clinical trials led by the National Institute of Immunology in New Delhi find that an add-on therapy can help tuberculosis patients combat multi-drug resistance. Vidyarthi Vigyan Manthan program announced to popularize science among the students of class 6th to class 11th. And now the news in detail. The Council for Science and Industrial Research, or CSIR, which is mandated to maintain the Indian Standard Time, that is IST, and the Indian Space Research Organization, or ISRO, have signed an MOU for exchanging time and frequency traceability to bring accuracy in satellite navigation. Once implemented, India will not have to depend on the US-based Global Positioning System or the GPS. Science Monitor brings you the good news.
India on the 4th of August 2017 took a major step to help the strategic and other sectors in the country to be independent of the US-based Global Positioning System or GPS. This advancement will help in improving navigation and providing accurate time in mobile phone applications for mapping, driving, hiking in jungles and remote areas. Some other advantages are high-speed communication, call or video conferencing, financial transactions, stock handling, digital archiving and international trade. So far, India is dependent on the GPS for its navigational information. The world's timing centers, such as the Coordinated Universal Time or UTC, have agreed to keep their time scales closely synchronized. This UTC has uncertainty of 20 nanoseconds. To make it more precise, the Indian Space Research Organization, or ISRO, has recently set up an indigenous regional navigational positioning system named as Navigation with Indian Constellation based on the Indian clock system instead of the US. ISRO has signed an agreement with the Council of Scientific and Industrial Research, or CSIR, and the New Delhi-based National Physical Laboratory, NPL, under which it will provide the UTC traceability to the time scale of Indian Regional Navigational Satellite System, an independent navigational satellite system being developed by ISRO. NPL will be able to provide accurate time by maintaining a group of several CZM atomic clocks with stringent environmental control and uninterrupted power. A cesium clock operates by exposing cesium atoms to microwaves and then counting the vibration of atoms as a measure of time. Cesium is a metallic element. A cesium clock can maintain time with an accuracy of 2 nanoseconds per day or 1 second in 14 million years. The MOU was signed in the presence of Union Minister for Science and Technology, Dr. Harsh Vardhan, and the Minister of State for Department of Space, Jitendra Singh.
It has been found that we have to make our own GPS system in this country. And the name of that is called NAVIC. So essentially, they are the seven satellites. And they will give the imaging or mapping or navigation as the GPS does. So now the question was that how to give the primary time for this NAVIC system, which is a constellation of seven satellites. So, the agreement says that NPL will provide the 20 nanosecond accurate time to all the seven satellites. They will form the Desi GPS, which is called a NAVIC. And therefore, we will have the independency in our GPS system. So, this is all about the MOAs.
This would mean that there would be no difference at all between the time measurements provided by the NPL and GPS. The move to NPL timing would be highly advantageous as it would mean India will not depend on GPS anymore. According to CSIR, the accuracy of satellite navigation systems depends on the proper sync of onboard clocks. For navigation purposes, at least four satellites need to know a position accurately for which the time has to be accurate. This will be a huge step ahead for India in becoming self-reliant and help the economy develop in various sectors.
Researchers at the Indian Institute of Science, Education and Research in Kolkata have made a new material that can protect and prolong the life of wood, paper, metals and other materials from damage due to fire, water and corrosion. Take a look.
Our homes contain many objects made from wood, paper or metal. While wooden paper is at risk due to damage from fire, metals can be wasted away by corrosion. Traditionally, metals are prevented from corroding away by coating them with a layer of zinc or painting them and also by protecting them from water and humidity. Now, scientists at the Department of Chemistry of the Indian Institute of Science Education and Research, Kolkata, have made a new revolutionary material that can be used for all three, wood, paper and metal, to safeguard them against fire, water and corrosion. Scientists have shown that when this material is coated or even an easily combustible material like a matchstick, it does not ignite. And when coated on paper, it makes paper resistant to water and prevents the growth of the common lab bacteria Aishwarya coli, which in turn increases its shelf life. The new material is made using a mix of polyhedral, oligomeric, silsisquane or POS and diphenyline. POS is known to possess properties like high thermal stability and fire retarding ability. POS and diphenyline naturally repel water, and this water repelling nature is enhanced when combined. Through experiments with paper, scientists demonstrate some more fascinating properties of the new material. They used two types of paper, one coated with the new material and the other without any coating. They drenched both papers in water. While the paper without any coating stuck and could not be unfolded, the one with the coating unfolded easily and regained its original shape. The coating also enhanced the strength of the paper by 1.5 times. The scientists say that coating formed a new hydrogen bond with the cellulose molecules of paper that increases its strength and stability. The recent results have been published in the journal American Chemical Society Omega.
Recently, we are looking for a material that can be coated on any surface to protect against environmental pollution and corrosion.
The scientists also tested if the new material can be used to protect metals from corrosion, rusting and decay. They coated iron nails with the new material and exposed it to moisture and ambient temperature conditions for 12 hours to induce rust. They found that the iron nails that were coated with the new material did not rust, while the non-coated ones did. They did similar experiments with silver. Silver is known to turn black when it gets exposed to hydrogen sulfide gas. This gas is released by pollutants and during sludge waste degradation in sewers. Scientists found that when silver was coated with the new material, it remained shining despite exposure to hydrogen sulfide gas, while the non-coated silver turned black. Scientists say coating metals with the new material prevents corrosion because it is water resistant, which prevents chemical reactions that induce rust and decay.
This compound can be coated on any wooden surface or any other surface and make that surface fire retardant. And I am hopeful that this compound we can use for protection of artifacts and historical materials containing metals.
This new material is soluble in organic solvents at room temperature, which makes it easy to apply on paper, wood and metal surfaces. Instead of finding individual solutions to protect wood, paper and metal objects in our homes, this new material can single-handedly help save them from fire and corrosion. It will also help to preserve artifacts of historical importance and in the metal industry for preventing corrosion, both of great economic value.
Another quick breather here, and after the break we will tell you about a new add-on therapy that will help TB patients combat multi-drug resistance. Keep watching Science Monitor.
Tales that inspire. Stories of social change. A salute to diversity. Promoting public discourse. Events that motivate. Inspiring the innovative spirit. Watch Rajya Sabha television documentaries.
Thanks for staying with us. Tuberculosis affects nearly 4.8 million Indians. But some patients develop a multi-drug resistant TB that cannot be cured by available drugs. And now, a new multi-centric clinical trial conducted in India by the Indian Institute of Immunology and 10 other institutes has found that a new add-on therapy can help multi-drug resistant TB patients. Here is our special report.
If untreated, tuberculosis is a fatal disease that affects nearly 48 lakh Indians. The symptoms include persistent cough, weight loss, night sweats and fever. TB is detected by a sputum test, which is considered more reliable than a chest X-ray because it can detect even small numbers of TB bacteria under the microscope, which the chest X-ray may miss. Tuberculosis can spread from an infected person to a normal person when the TB patient releases bacteria during coughing and sneezing. A treatment for TB is available, which is known as DOTS or directly observed treatment short course, in which the patients are given routine doses of antibiotics such as rifampicin, streptomycin and ethambutol. In some cases where the patients do not take the medicines regularly, the disease can reappear and become multi-drug resistance or MDR-TB. MDR-TB patients are difficult to be cured by available antibiotics. In a recent advancement, scientists have found that an add-on therapy can increase the efficacy of the existing TB treatment and help MDR-TB patients. They found the add-on therapy useful by conducting a prospective double-blind, placebo-controlled, randomized, multicentric clinical trial in India in Category 2 TB patients who are likely to develop MDR-TB.
Normally, there is a multi-drug therapy which is given to tuberculosis patients. But sometimes, due to default or relapse, these patients get TB again, which is called Category 2 TB patients. And this Category 2 TB can convert into multi-drug resistant TB. So normal treatment is about 6 months to a year or 1 year and a half if it is non-pulmonary TB. What we have tried to do is give Mycobacterium indica spranii, which is an immunomodulator, along with standard multi-drug therapy to the patients, and a same number of controls were given placebo. And what we found was that the MIP, that is MIP, Mycobacterium indica spranii, converts the patient's culture into negativity in 4 weeks.
To test the new add-on therapy for TB, scientists did a clinical study in different parts of India with 890 patients. One group of patients received the add-on therapy along with DOTS, while the other received only DOTS and a placebo. The add-on therapy consisted of injections of a strain of TB bacteria called Mycobacterium indica spranii. According to scientists, 67% patients who got the add-on therapy converted to sputum culture negative compared to only 57% in the placebo group in 4 weeks' time. By the end of the therapy, after 2 years, add-on therapy helped 94.2% patients recover compared to only 89% in the placebo group.
To overcome the disadvantage of multiple injections, we are trying aerosol route of immunization in animal models of tuberculosis. Since aerosol route or intranasal route, it directly targets the lung, it has shown very good protective efficacy, much higher as compared to the intradermal injections.
At present, the new add-on therapy can be given as regular injections. Since some patients may be reluctant to take injections in the long run, the scientists are now testing if the new add-on therapy can be given through a nasal route, similar to how asthma patients take their medicine.
Vigyan Prasar, an autonomous organization under the Department of Science and Technology, in association with the National Council of Education, Research and Training, or the NCRT, and Vijayan Bharati, are conducting a national talent search examination for the students of class 6th to 11th. Let us know more about this program.
Vidyarthi Vigyan Manthan is a national annual talent search science exam to identify students with a scientific bent of mind. The program is organized for the students of class 6th to 11th in association with National Council of Educational Research and Training, NCERT. Vijayan Bharati and Vigyan Prasar, an autonomous institute of the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India. Interested students have to enroll for the exam through their schools at Vidyarthi Vigyan Manthan's website, which is www.vvm.org.in.
The objective of Vidyarthi Vigyan Manthan is to make the young generation, especially the school-going children, to make them aware about the India's contribution to the science, number one. Number two is that they must be aware that what is the contribution put forth by the Indian scientists. So every year, this particular program emphasize and focus the Indian scientist. This year, we are going to project Dr. Vikram Sarabhai as well as Dr. Homi Jahangir Bhabha. So live glimpses of both these scientists as well as Indian contribution to science will be the 40% syllabus for these students. 40% syllabus will be from their science and mathematics textbooks, which they are studying in their schools, and 20% syllabus will be from logic, reasoning and general knowledge. As far as how many times it has been conducted at national level, this is the 6th edition, which we are happening at the 2017-18. And as far as the last year's record is concerned, that it was the highest achieved number, which was 1,05,000 number of students appeared last year. This year, we are optimistic that we will cross this number.
The students who enroll for the program undergo multi-level tests. These include objective type questions, comprehensive writing, presentation and group discussions, role play, hands-on training and practical examination. The program is divided into four levels: school, district, state and national. Winners will receive cash awards, a certificate of merit, a memento, along with a visit to the National Research Laboratory.
From 1st of July, the registrations are open. The registration will be closed on 20th of September 2017. Exam date is on the 26th of November 2017, and the results will be in the month of December. And after that, as and when the things move, all the students will be informed through the mobiles, SMS, website and all. This year, we are trying to make this examination or competition happen through the digital devices. So basically, students are going to come with their own devices, with their own internet connectivity to the respective schools from where they are going to register. They can give the examinations through mobile, laptop and tablet. They have to come with their devices.
The examination will be conducted in several languages including English, Hindi, Malayalam, Tamil, Kannada, Telugu, Marathi, Gujarati, Odia, Bengali and Punjabi. Apart from the NCERT's science and mathematics syllabus, students will have to answer questions from study material provided by the organizing committee. These will include topics like Indian scientists' contribution to science, logical reasoning and general knowledge. During the course of the program, students will also get an opportunity to interact with renowned scientists. The national winner of Vidyarthi Vigyan Manthan will receive the title of Vigyan Jigyasu or Keen Knowledge Seeker of Science.
It is time for a short break here, but there is lots more coming up on Science Monitor, so keep watching.
Jade was popular during Mughal era and gained prominence during Akbar's rule in 15th and 16th century. It came all the way from Iran and Central Asia in a trio of colors. The royalty had a unique use for it, since jade changed color when it came in contact with arsenic, They start at utensils like plates, jars, bowls, and even hookah with it. And thereby avoided getting poisoned by rivals.
This is Kibutu in Arunachal Pradesh, East Point East on the map of India. Kibutu is dangerously close to the Chinese pressure point.
We see firsthand and unseen areas of sand dunes and see how BSF is guarding this difficult territory along the Indo-Pak borderline.
We are now slowly entering into the interiormost parts of the Sarkirik area. Indo-Tibetan Border Police Force justifies each word of this thing.
Watch super exclusive episodes of National Security Series only on Rajya Sabha Television.
Let us now take a quick look at some more scientific innovations and developments from India and around the world.
India's leading scientist, Pushpa Mitra Bhargav, who founded the Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology in Hyderabad, passed away on 1st August at the age of 89 years due to a prolonged kidney ailment. He was a veteran molecular biologist and vehement critic of genetically modified crops. He was awarded the Padma Bhushan for his contribution to the field of biology and formulating science policies for India. He will always remain close to our hearts. In a leading achievement for India, Professor Dinesh Mohan of the Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi, has been elected Fellow of Europe's Royal Society of Chemistry. Dinesh Mohan has been acknowledged for his work on developing eco-friendly technology for crop burning, water purification, and for making biofuels from dried plants. India witnessed a lunar eclipse on August 7, 2017 at 9:20 p.m. The lunar eclipse occurred on the night of 7th August and continued till early Tuesday morning. It was visible in Asia, Europe and Africa. A lunar eclipse is an event when the sun, the earth and the moon aligns in an almost straight line, with the moon appearing darkened because it passes into the earth's shadow. The Nehru Planetarium had set up telescopes to help visitors observe the lunar eclipse in various parts of the country. A recent study from the Institute of Stem Cell Biology and Regenerative Medicine in Bangalore, India, has found that flatworms whose head have been decapitated can still detect light. The research published in the journal Science has made international headlines and will help scientists in finding how animals recover after injuries and reveal additional details about the evolution of eyes. A year ago, a team of scientists led by Professor Ravindra Kotnala at the National Physical Laboratory in New Delhi made a fascinating innovation of generating electricity from water at room temperature. The innovation, named hydroelectric cell, is now ready for the next stage of development. The hydroelectric cell derives energy through redox reaction. The scientists have improved the current output and are now setting up pilot plants to make the innovation available to the industry.
And this week in the history of science, we remember Thomas Alva Edison, who invented the mimeograph, which was an innovation much ahead of its time. Now, before printers and photocopiers became the popular choice for making copies of an original, the only form of copying was with carbon papers. And even though a printing press could be employed to print thousands of copies, it was neither cheap nor practical for a lesser number. Thomas Alva Edison invented the mimeograph to fill in this space. In the same decade that Edison demonstrated the phonograph and invented the incandescent lamp, he received a patent for another invention, a mimeograph. On 8th of August 1876, Edison received a patent for this invention titled Improvement in Autographic Printing. Edison invented a portable perforating stylus for writing or drawing, whereby a vertical perforating needle with a battery-operated reciprocating mechanism could be used to draw on a paper. This could then make multiple copies. Edison's patent covered an electric pen for cutting stencils and the flatbed duplicating press. The business model was also straightforward as it involved selling the machines, stencils, and the ink. Edison, who gave the world some of the biggest inventions known to mankind, continues to be an inspiration for the world. That is it from me and the entire Science Monitor team in this episode. We are keen to receive your views and suggestions for our program. Please mail us on news@vigyanprasar.gov.in. You can also write in to us at Vigyan Prasar C24, Kutub Institutional Area, New Delhi 110016. Thanks for tuning in. Hope to see you again next week for another interesting episode of Science News and Innovations. Till then, goodbye and take care.